Well, good evening. Welcome to our Good Friday service here at College Church. Tonight, we're entering once again into the story of Passion Week. In particular, the climactic part of the story. The events immediately leading up to and including Jesus' crucifixion. It's often said that the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, are passion narratives with extended introductions. And though a bit oversimplified, it makes a crucial point. Jesus came into the world in order to die for sinners. He himself referred to it as his hour. An hour, not ultimately of shame, but of glory. It's a weighty hour. And so as we enter in tonight, may we perceive and feel afresh the weight of glory that is the wondrous cross. Let's pray together. Oh God, I ask that you would grant us all tonight a sight, a true sight of the glory of Jesus in the cross. Grant us that we would indeed perceive and feel the weight of this hour, the weight of this glory through the readings from your word, through the songs that we will sing, through the hearing of your word preached. Grant us this tonight, we pray, O God. In Jesus' name, amen. Jesus lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that the Son may glorify you, since you have given him authority over all flesh, to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth, having accomplished the work that you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had with you before the world existed."
Jesus went out with his disciples across the brook Kidron, where there was a garden which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, for Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas, having procured a band of soldiers and some officers from the chief priests and the Pharisees, went there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that would happen to him, came forward and said to them, "Whom do you seek?" They answered him, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus said to them, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. So he asked them again, "Whom do you seek?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. So if you seek me, let these men go." This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "Of those whom you gave me, I have lost not one." Then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's servant and cut off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus. So Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword into its sheath. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father has given me?" So the band of soldiers and their captain and the officers of the Jews arrested Jesus and bound him. First they led him to Annas, for he was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was the high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who advised the Jews that it would be expedient that one man should die for the people. Simon Peter followed Jesus, and so did another disciple. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he entered with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest, but Peter stood outside at the door. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out and spoke to the servant girl who kept watch at the door and brought Peter in. The servant girl at the door said to Peter, "You also are not one of this man's disciples, are you?" He said, "I am not." Now the servants and officers had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing and warming themselves. Peter also was with them, standing and warming himself. The high priest then questioned Jesus about his disciples and his teaching. Jesus answered him, "I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple where all Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Ask those who have heard me what I said to them. They know what I said." When he had said these things, one of the officers standing by struck Jesus with his hand, saying, "Is that how you answer the high priest?" Jesus answered him, "If what I said is wrong, bear witness about the wrong. But if what I said is right, why do you strike me?" Annas then sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. So they said to him, "You also are not one of his disciples, are you?" He denied it and said, "I am not." One of the servants of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked, "Did I not see you in the garden with him?" Peter again denied it, and at once a rooster crowed. Then they led Jesus from the house of Caiaphas to the governor's headquarters. It was early morning. They themselves did not enter the governor's headquarters so that they would not be defiled, but could eat the Passover. So Pilate went outside to them and said, "What accusation do you bring against this man?" They answered him, "If this man were not doing evil, we would not have delivered him over to you." Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and judge him by your own law." The Jews said to him, "It is not lawful for us to put anyone to death." This was to fulfill the word that Jesus had spoken, to show by what kind of death he was going to die. So Pilate entered his headquarters again and called Jesus and said to him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you say this of your own accord, or did others say it to you about me?" Pilate answered, "Am I a Jew? Your own nation and the chief priests have delivered you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would have been fighting that I might not be delivered over to the Jews. But my kingdom is not from the world." Then Pilate said to him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this purpose I was born, and for this purpose I have come into the world, to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth listens to my voice." Pilate said to him, "What is truth?" After he had said this, he went back outside to the Jews and told them, "I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I should release one man for you at the Passover. So do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?" They cried out, "Not this man, but Barabbas." Now Barabbas was a robber. Then Pilate took Jesus and flogged him, and the soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head and arrayed him in a purple robe. They came up to him saying, "Hail, King of the Jews," and struck him with their hands. Pilate went out again and said to them, "See, I am bringing him out to you that you may know that I find no guilt in him." So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, "Behold the man." When the chief priests and the officers saw him, they cried out, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and crucify him, for I find no guilt in him." The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die because he has made himself the Son of God."
Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, We remember tonight the pain and suffering of the cross. We remember all that you endured, the hate, the betrayal, the false accusations, the mockery, the crown of thorns, the excruciating loneliness. And we remember why. To bear the awesome weight of our sin. Amazingly, you never strayed from the path of obedience to your Father, even when that path led you to the cross and the scorn of those who should have worshiped and adored you. Like a sheep before its shearers is silent, you did not open your mouth, but entrusted yourself to your Father who judges justly. Your plan was to redeem us from the curse of sin by becoming a curse for us. Our sin was condemned in your body that we might find forgiveness and freedom. In so doing, you proved to be the great shepherd, laying down your life for us, your beloved sheep. You were torn for all our sinful and rebellious wandering, that we might be brought into your fold, into the family of God, and through your wounds, find healing and peace. Thank you, Jesus, for the cross. Yet even now, as your sheep, and as the children of God, amazed by your grace, we still at times love evil and resist what is good. We criticize the moral decline of our culture, yet fail to decry the moral laxity in our own hearts and families. We demand justice for ourselves, but fail to pursue it vigorously on behalf of others. We've grumbled about your providence and the circumstances of our lives instead of recognizing and delighting in your wisdom that does all things well. Forgive us, Lord. And remind us, even now, of your great love for us, so clearly and powerfully demonstrated at the cross, where you were made to be sin, though completely innocent, in order that we, holy guilty sinners, might be counted righteous in God's sight. Thank you, Jesus, for suffering the most profound injustice so that we could be justified. Thank you, Jesus, for looking not only to your own interests, but to ours as you gave your life for us. Help us imitate you, Lord, and love others in their great need as you have loved us in ours. Cause us to love justice and, like you, suffer joyfully in service of others. And help us never lose the wonder of the cross. In your name we pray. Amen.
When Pilate heard this statement that he had made himself the Son of God, he was even more afraid. He entered into his headquarters again and said to Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. So Pilate said to him, "You will not speak to me? Do you not know that I have authority to release you and authority to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You would have no authority over me at all unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, he who delivered me over to you has the greater sin." From then on, Pilate sought to release him, but the Jews cried out, "If you release this man, you are not Caesar's friend." Everyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar. So when Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and sat down on the judgment seat at a place called the Stone Pavement, and in Aramaic, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of the preparation of the Passover. It was about the sixth hour. He said to the Jews, "Behold your king." They cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but Caesar." So he delivered him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and he went out bearing his own cross to the place called the Place of a Skull, which in Aramaic is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, and Jesus between them. Pilate also wrote an inscription and put it on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this inscription, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Aramaic, in Latin, and in Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write 'the King of the Jews,' but rather, 'This man said, I am the King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written."
I watched them take him up the mountainside, where he was crucified, though innocent. They mocked him, they cursed him with their mouths, and they told him to come down if he was God. My heart broke in my chest when I heard him say, "Forgive." It is finished. Oh, oh, oh. And I can still feel the anguish when they pierce him. Ground beneath us shook upon the very moment that he died. Oh, 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 oh. Thank you.
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his garments and divided them into four parts, one part for each soldier. Also his tunic, but the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from top to bottom. So they said to one another, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to see whose it shall be." This was to fulfill the scripture, which says, "They divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots." So the soldiers did these things. But standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother, and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her to his home. After this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said, "To fulfill the scripture, I thirst." A jar full of sour wine stood there, so they put a sponge full of the sour wine on a hyssop branch and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, "It is finished." And he bowed his head and he gave up his spirit.
Thank you. Good evening. I invite you to turn with me in your Bibles to the Gospel of John, second half of the Bible. You'll find Bibles in the pew racks in front of you. If you haven't brought a Bible, you can't find one, that's just fine. I'll read it out for us. John chapter 10, and we're looking this evening at verses 7 through to verse 9. Let's bow our heads and pray as we come now to God's Word. Let's pray. Father God, thank you so much for the opportunity this evening, never to be repeated, this 2024, this Good Friday. We pray, Lord, that we would have an encounter with you tonight, as we sing, as we pray, and now through your word. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So friends, John chapter 10, and I'll read to us from verses 7 to verse 9. So Jesus again said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture." In 2015, the Pixar movie company produced a movie called Inside Out. You haven't seen it, it's a lot of fun to see. I've seen it, I think, a couple of times with our family over the years. Inside Out tells the story of a young girl named Riley. It's an animated cartoon. And inside her mind, as you see the movie, the viewer watches a set of personified basic emotions, and they interact together and they attempt to keep Riley well balanced as she goes through some pretty traumatic moments in her life. And these personified emotions are joy, sadness, fear, disgust, and anger. And it's very entertaining to watch how they interact together. Memorial services are normally thought to be sad, maybe filled with regret. What could have been, what you wish you had said to the person who's gone, who's no longer here. What you wish you did, but you did not do, or what you wish you had not done, but you did. Maybe a longing for the days that have gone. And if there is any happiness to a typical memorial service, it's a feeling of wistful longing for perhaps some would feel sentimental hope for a future reunion. Or maybe a feeling of pleasant nostalgia of days gone by. But here we are. We are on Good Friday. And it is called Good for a reason. It is not a sad day. The renowned preacher Charles Spurgeon put it like this: "The memorial of Christ's death is a festival, not a funeral." So we're looking this evening at the next few moments at John chapter 10, and we're seeing how Jesus, as this is the second in our series that we began on Palm Sunday and will conclude on Easter Sunday, how Jesus is the answer to our suffering. And this evening we will see that it is because he provides for us. Now, it's important as we look at John's gospel, and our aim is that we would have a transcendent encounter with Jesus himself through his word, and therefore we need to set it in context. John's gospel has an overall message. His message is that we might believe in order to find life. He makes that claim at the end of his gospel. That's why he's writing. And he says at the beginning too, in him, that is in Jesus, is life. And John's gospel is set up basically into two sections. Most scholars would agree with that. First part is the book of signs, which we're in here in chapter 10. And the second half is the book of glory, which all centers around the cross. And this chapter 10 obviously comes after chapter 9, and it is an explanation of a sign related to suffering. Jesus has just healed a blind man. And the disciples have asked him, why is this man suffering? Did he do something wrong? Did his parents do something wrong? Why was he born blind? And Jesus says, no, it's so that you might see the glory of God. In other words, that you might see that Jesus is the answer to suffering. And then in chapter 10, he explains that. And so as we come to this series, we looked on Sunday at how Jesus protects you, and then tonight we'll see how he, that is Jesus, provides for you in four simple ways. First, Jesus provides access for you. He says, twice repeated in our few verses this evening, I am the door. He's providing access for you. It's a remarkable claim. Jesus is saying, he is the way into the church. And that claim needs to be put again front and center and re-emphasized in church today. Jesus is the door to the church. Jesus himself, by his Spirit, brings people into the church. He is the door. No human, Jesus himself is the door to the church. And of course, what that means is the door is not ultimately baptism, nor is it ultimately communion or the Lord's Supper. Important as those things are, but the way to come into the church is through Jesus himself. It also means the door is not knowing about Jesus. Many people know about Jesus, but they haven't come through Jesus. You may well know a lot about Jesus. You may have studied him and grown up as a Christian. You know a lot about Jesus, but he himself is the door, not merely knowing about him. Nor is the door having the right doctrine. I think a lot of Bible students confuse that. They think, oh, I know a lot about the right kind of doctrine, and therefore I must be saved, and I know the right answers to the right questions. No, that's not the door. The door is Jesus himself. Second, Jesus provides teaching for you. His sheep listen. My friends, an identifying characteristic of a follower of Jesus is that they are a listener of Jesus. If we follow Jesus, we listen to Jesus. We listen to his teaching. Shepherds, Jesus here is of course saying that he is the good shepherd. Shepherds shepherd by teaching. That's how Jesus shepherds. And those of us who are called to be under shepherds, Jesus is the good shepherd, pastors and elders and Christian leaders are under shepherds. Those of us who are called to be under shepherds, we shepherd by pointing the sheep to God's word. And that's why at College Church you'll always find the Bible is at the heart of what we do, because we want you, each of us, all of us, me and you, to be shepherded by Jesus himself through his word. And we want to listen to that teaching. It's so important today we have that right. There are many other voices out there, aren't there? And Jesus indicates that. He says, all who came before me have been thieves and robbers. And of course, there have been many other thieves and robbers since him too. Those that Jesus is contrasting himself with are fake and false shepherds, thieves and robbers, who come to steal and kill and not to teach the truth in accordance with God's word. So many people are confused today. That's why there's so much conflict in our culture. That's why there's so much division. Confusion is the reason. We don't know which way is up anymore. We live in an information age, but we do not live in a wisdom age. People are confused. What we need is God's word. We need to give time to God's word. And if we're a follower of Jesus, we will hunger for Jesus' word. We will listen to Jesus. Third, Jesus provides salvation for you. Most important, of course, most delightful, most significant, most eternally valuable. We'll be saved. Good Friday is called Good Friday because it is at the cross that Jesus saved. What does it mean when he says they will enter in? What does it mean to enter in order to be saved? To enter in means to believe. That's what it means, to believe. The scandal of the cross, and it is a scandalous message we're looking at tonight. The scandal of the cross is that you will be saved if you only believe. How scandalous that is. Many moral people will not be saved because they do not believe. We will be saved only through belief, entering in. I sometimes like to put it like this. I got this from a friend who's another pastor, and he used this illustration many, many times and many years ago, and I've always loved it. Faith is empty hands. That's what faith is. You come to God and you say, Lord, I'm broken. I'm hurting. I'm sinful. I have nothing. Help. Nothing in your hand you bring. Simply to his cross you cling. And you enter in. It is faith alone. But if you are filled with faith, you will be faithful, of course. It's faith alone, but not the kind of faith that remains alone, which is not really faith. If you're filled with faith, you'll be faithful. What are you saved from? You're saved from death, eternal death, and you're saved for life. Now, an eternal life. We'll be thinking more about what that life is, of course, on Sunday. Fourth, he provides food for you. It's wonderful, a picture, isn't it? They go in and out and they find pasture. Why in and out? Why backwards and forwards? Because what Jesus is saying is we need to constantly come back to the message of the cross, constantly come back to the gospel, in and out and find pasture. The message of the cross that we're thinking about this evening, the message of the gospel is not merely the ABC of the Christian faith, the basics, 101, Christianity, the cross. No. You go in and out and find pastures through the cross. The message of the cross is the A to Z of the Christian faith. That's how you find food. That's how you find spiritual nourishment, through the message of the cross. We feed on the gospel. That's how we are encouraged and strengthened. That's how we find purpose. He who died for me, what would I not give for him and for his kingdom? That's how we find meaning. Our life has so much more meaning now, eternal meaning. Everything we do now has eternal significance if we give our lives to Jesus, if we enter in, if we believe. So, my friends, he provides for you. He provides access for you, teaching for you, salvation for you, and ongoing food and nourishment, encouragement, pasture for you. There was once a great thinker who said this, and I won't say his name tonight, but it's a real quotation from a great philosopher. He said this: talent hits a target no one else can hit. Genius hits a target no one else can see. Well, the cross is a work of divine genius. Saving what no one else and nothing else could save, namely me, you, us. On October the 1st, 2017, in the Las Vegas 91 Harvest Country Musical Festival, 60 people were murdered. And as that news story was unfolding, all the international news people turned up, of course, and at 4:29 a.m. the next morning, Taylor Benji looked into the camera of her particular cable news network that she was reporting to and said this, "I know I cannot speak for everyone, but for me, I was an agnostic going into that concert, but I'm a firm believer in God now." Well, in a similitude, the cross has done something a bit like that to millions. You stare at the cross and you find salvation. Saving what no one else and nothing else could save. Me, you, us, by his blood. And that is not sad. Let's pray together. Our Father God, we do thank you so much for the cross. We thank you for this opportunity we have tonight to not only celebrate the cross, but to believe and be saved. Work in our hearts by your Spirit, we pray. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Since it was the day of preparation, and so that the bodies would not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for that Sabbath was a high day, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once there came out blood and water. He who saw it has borne witness. His testimony is true, and he knows that he is telling the truth, that you also may believe. For these things took place that the scripture might be fulfilled. Not one of his bones will be broken. And again, another scripture says, they will look on him whom they have pierced. After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus, and Pilate gave him permission. So he came and took away his body. Nicodemus also, who earlier had come to Jesus by night, came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds in weight. So they took the body of Jesus and bound it in linen cloths with the spices, as is the burial custom of the Jews. Now in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden. And in the garden, a new tomb in which no one had yet been laid. So because of the Jewish day of preparation, since the tomb was close at hand, they laid Jesus there.
His body.